Praise be to God. Once again, as we come before the Lord our God this morning, we are grateful that we can listen to Him. The Lord is not vague concerning His thoughts and His will for us. He never said that as you go and live in the world today, you find out by trial and error what He wants. No, He gave us His Word. Okay? The Lord said to us that from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Well, we get a glimpse of that by the words that we have here in the Holy Scriptures. We see what is in the heart of God, and God has given us the Holy Spirit, whom we also know as the Spirit of Truth, that He guides us and leads us into all truth. And today, as we've gone through our the readings, our theme for today basically is the goal of sensitivity to the needy. Well, praise be to God. Let me ask you again, how are you today? Which is really our lesson for today, that God blesses us, that we might be a blessing to others. Okay? God blesses us, that we might be a blessing to others. Okay? Earlier we confessed the word of God that we are blessed with believing Abraham. We know that the blessing of Abraham is ours through Jesus Christ. Amen? But the promise that God gave to Abraham, God said to Abraham, I will bless you that you might become a blessing to others. And so praise be to God, we are grateful for the blessing of God. Amen? See, when we think about the blessing of God, we automatically think about the things that we can do, the places that we can go, certain things that we couldn't do before or purchase before because they were beyond our means. When we think about the blessing of God, we think, well, okay, those doors are open to us now. We simply think about our wants, our desires. But that's not how God views prosperity for us. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay? To paraphrase one comic writer, all right, we could say it this way: with great prosperity comes great responsibility. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay, so we need to understand that in the beginning, probably we may not have much, but as we begin to walk in the principles of God Almighty, as we begin to apply the principles of God, then we begin to put ourselves in a path where the blessings are. Do you understand what I'm saying? We take out the stops in our lives that enable us to receive instead of rejecting the blessings of God. A good example probably would be in the area of unforgiveness. Maybe in the beginning, someone offended us and we've held that against them. And even probably that person might have come to us and repented and apologized. We simply would not refuse. We simply would refuse to forgive that particular person. And, you know, while we are walking in unforgiveness, we kind of wonder why our lives are dry. We kind of wonder why our prayers aren't really getting answered that much. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay? We kind of wonder why it seems like God is so distant. Okay? But then, when we come to the Lord and we learn about this, maybe it is with a painful gesture, but eventually we say, okay, God, I choose to forgive this person. I really do not like to. I really do not want to. I really, really, really feel that person doesn't deserve my forgiveness. And the only reason that I'm going to forgive this person is because you're the one who asked me to do it. If my mom asked me to do it, I won't forgive. If my husband asked me to do it, I will not forgive. If my children asked me to do it, I will not forgive. If my boss asked me to do it, I will not forgive. If all the presidents of the world ask me to, I will not forget. But you're the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Just because you said so. Okay, I forgive. You understand what I'm saying? All right? And then you forgive, and as you do, suddenly you open the door of your life to certain blessings. One of them is answered prayer. Do you understand what I'm saying? You begin to see the favor of God begin to flow through you. You see, unforgiveness is not walking in a state of grace. How many of you believe you've been forgiven by God? Okay, let me ask you this. How many of you believe you were forgiven by God because you deserve that forgiveness? Okay? Do you deserve the forgiveness that God gave you? Do you deserve Jesus Christ suffering for you, dying on the cross for you, and rising from the grave for you, and getting you saved you? Now you're justified. Do you deserve that? Not really. None of us deserve that. The only reason God forgave us, the only reason God gave us His only Son, because He loved us. You understand what I'm saying? There's nothing in us that can even give a clue or an idea that somehow, one way or the other, we are entitled to the forgiveness of God. We deserve it. He owes it to us. You understand what I'm saying? There's nothing in there that can indicate that. The only reason God forgave us is because He loves us and God is good. Amen? So we need to understand that. We don't deserve it. There's nothing in us that could demand of God, well, God, You created us, You might as well forgive us. No, you can't do that. Because we were created in the image of God, and we were placed in Adam, in a perfect garden. But we sinned through Him. God could have said, okay, I gave you everything. Perfect environment, no sin. No, I asked of the, and let's say there's like 1 million trees there. And all I ask from you is that of all the other trees here, you can only eat from 999,999 trees. It's only from one tree that you're not supposed to eat. And you had to eat from that one. Shame on you! Now you're going to go to hell. That's what you deserve. Do you understand what I'm saying? But instead of having that attitude, God looked at us with love, compassion, and pity, and decided to save us. Actually, the decision to save us was made even before He created us. Okay? According to the book of Timothy, we were saved even before the foundation of the world. You understand what I'm saying? Even before He created us, He saw us, He loved us, and He made that decision for us. And the reason why we're forgiven today is because of the grace of God. You understand what I'm saying? The favor that we walk in is because of the grace of God. Amen? I mean, I can confess, my God supplies my every need according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And I can experience that. Why is that even possible for me? Because the grace of God provided that for me. Provided that for us. Do you understand what I'm saying? How many of you, when you've gotten sick, you have confessed by His stripes? I am healed, right? And how many of you received your healing? Just because you said it. Right? I mean, how is that even possible? Because God's grace provided that. Do you understand what I'm saying? How are you today? What's the conviction? I'm blessed to be a blessing. Why are you even blessed? Grace? Do you understand what I'm saying? And so when you choose to not forgive someone, okay, you're kind of closing that grace, and you're cutting yourself off from the blessings of God. But then you say, okay, God, I choose to forgive. Now you open yourself up again. Are you understanding what I'm saying? And so now you begin to walk in the blessings of God. And the blessings of God, yeah, you get forgiveness. You've got the spiritual blessing there. You've got the peace of God suddenly flooding your heart and your mind. You get that assurance, okay, everything is all right between me and my Father, so therefore everything is all right in the world. Okay, you have that confidence of when I ask the Father in the name of Jesus, He's going to hear me and answer me. Do you understand what I'm saying? So you've got the spiritual blessings. Then, you know, we've got also the physical blessings. How many of you have received healing because of prayer, the laying on of hands, intercession, confession of the Word of God? How many of you have received that? Okay? That's part of the blessing of God Almighty. It's grace. And then also finances. Okay, that's part of the blessing of God Almighty. All right? And you know what? When God gives us, based on Jesus multiplying the bread and the fish, first for a crowd of 4,000, and then for another crowd of 5,000, and we're just counting the men. Okay? It says there that after He's provided for the needs, there was so much in excess. Do you understand what I'm saying? I believe that God is a God of abundance. Remember the prayer that Jesus Christ taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom, thy will be done. Where? On earth as it is in heaven, right? Let me ask you this. Is there poverty in heaven? Is there poverty or lack in heaven? None. He asks us to pray that way. You understand what I'm saying? See, some people have a problem with abundance. And I know that's been abused. And we've got the term prosperity gospel. You know, and if I am getting the idea right, they preach that, you know, you need Jesus so that you might become rich. Well, that's not the purpose, actually, of accepting the Lord. The reason why you accept Jesus is so that you might be reconciled to God, our Father. You understand what I'm saying? Hello? But as you do, and you walk in obedience to God, all right, the blessings of God begin to affect every area of your life. Hello? And abundance begin to flow. Hello? And just because some people abuse the prosperity that God gives them does not make the message wrong. Let me ask you. Has God forgiven our sin? Yes. And do you believe that we need to repent? If we sin, you know, again, we believe we have to repent to receive the forgiveness of God. There's nothing wrong with the message of God's grace, forgiveness of our sins, right? Right? Nothing wrong. Yet, there are those who preach a different kind of grace. They call it hyper grace. Okay? And basically, their premise is this. Jesus' death on the cross paid the price of sins committed in the past. Correct? Correct? Yes. Sins that are being committed in the present. Correct? What happened? Sins being committed in the present. Does the sacrifice of Christ pay for that? Sin and the sacrifice of Christ also pays for sins that will yet be committed in the future. Yes or no?
Yes,
correct, right? I mean, the sacrifice of Christ was so complete. There's no sin that can slip past the blood of Christ. Past, present, and future. But they make this conclusion. Therefore, since the grace of Christ forgives us, past, present, and future, I don't sin anymore. I can live like the world, and I don't sin anymore. That's a wrong conclusion. You understand what I'm saying? It doesn't make the message wrong. Okay? Some people have abused the message of grace. It doesn't make the message of grace wrong. The solution is not to stop preaching the message of grace. The solution is to keep on preaching and teaching it correctly. Okay? And it's the same thing with the message of abundance and prosperity in the gospel. Just because there are others who abuse that does not make the message wrong. Hello? He became poor for our sakes. That we, through his poverty, might become rich in him. Oh, that only refers to spiritual riches. You sure? When Abraham went into a covenant with God, you know what happened to him, right? When David went into a covenant with God, you know what happened to him, right? I mean, he wanted to build a temple for God. God said to him, sorry, David, you're a man of war. You've got blood in your hands, so you're not going to build it. Your son will. Okay, and David set aside silver and gold and everything just for the temple to be built. Right? People think that only the rich people of the world, prosperity only belongs to the people of the world. It's not what the Bible says. As a matter of fact, the Bible says the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just. You understand what I'm saying? And here in this particular scriptures, we're getting a lot of things. Advice from God. That even when you begin to receive the blessings of God, it begins to affect you spiritually, mentally, emotionally, physically, and then financially and materially, okay? That we are to behave like citizens of the kingdom of heaven. We are to do with financial blessings what God says to do with that in his word. That is a mark of a prosperous soul, because that's what John said, right? I wish above all things that you may prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. You've got to prosper inside first. That's where prosperity begins. You understand? It doesn't begin with your wallet. Doesn't begin with your bank account. Starts inside. Okay? Your number one focus in life must not be your career. Must not be the fulfillment of your dreams. Must not be your bank account. Must not be your finances. The number one focus of your life must be God. You understand what I'm saying? Hello? So we need to understand that, church. That, you know, if you're poor, you don't focus in your poverty and lament that you don't have the bricks. Focus on God. If you're rich, okay, you don't focus on how what people are saying about you. Because if you're rich, they'll definitely say nice things about you. Okay? You might even get featured in a magazine somewhere. The guy who made it successful, you know. Don't believe your own publicity. You understand what I'm saying? Bible says, when riches increase, do not set your heart on them. Abraham doesn't say, when riches increase, rebuke it in the name of Jesus. That's not what it says. You understand what I'm saying? When riches increase, run the other way. That's not what it says. See, God would rather have the righteous have the wealth than the unrighteous. Okay? I mean, we're seeing the effects of this in one of the leading countries in the world. The elites are using their wealth, okay, to bring into their nation unrighteous, ungodly laws. This is not something that the righteous would do. You understand what I'm saying? So we need to understand this, church. God wants you to be blessed in all areas, not just spiritually, not just physically, but also financially. But you've got to set your heart on Him. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind. Okay? Whether you're poor or you're rich, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart. You understand what I'm saying? Okay. Last week we heard the parable of the unjust steward. He used his position for his own welfare only. And the Lord said he was wise in that, in the sense that he used what was available to him so that he could prepare for a future. But then the point of that parable is not to be dishonest. But the point of that parable is to use what is within your means, and God has given us within our means, to prepare for our future, okay? Not just the immediate future in this life today, but the future after this life. You understand what I'm saying? God wants us to live in this earth with an eternal perspective. Amen? Okay? So we need to understand that too. So let me go to the first point I'd like to share with you. First point. I think I've shared this. I'm basing this in verse 19 to 21, is this: God's blessings are meant to be shared. God's blessings are meant to be shared. Verse 19 to 21. Verse 22 to 26, how we live now shapes our future. How we live now shapes our future. Verse 27 to 31, consider seriously the word of God. Consider seriously the word of God. Okay, let me just read verse 19 to 21. Okay, I'd like to be quick about this. All right. There was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. But there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, full of sores, who was laid at the gate, okay, desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. All right? Some people say this is a parable. Some say it's not a parable because there's someone who was named by Jesus, named Lazarus. But they say, some of the commentators say that, you know, he was the only one named in a parable. So this must be a true story. Well, whether the story is a true story or not, we want to be able to focus on the principle the Lord is showing us, right? Okay, so it says here, there was a certain rich man who was clothed in purple. He was very rich, because during that time, not many people are able to wear purple. Purple is the color of the rich and the famous during that particular time. As a matter of fact, there are certain codes of how much purple you can wear, all right? It was such a rare dye that it cannot be worn by just anyone. You've got to be up there to be able to wear this color. Amen? And the higher you are financially, the higher you are in influence, the higher you are in wealth, the more that you can wear this particular collar. Also says he was wearing fine linen. So you know that this guy was rich and he fared sumptuously every day. How many of you eat special foods during anniversaries? Christmas, okay? January 1, secular fiscal New Year's Day, or when the end comes along and your relatives come along, and on the third Sunday of January you have a feast, you've got special food. How many of you eat those? Now let me ask you this. Do you eat that every day?
No.
No, you don't, right? Only on special occasions, because that's kind of expensive. This guy does it every day. He eats gourmet food every day, all right? He fared sumptuously, banquet food every day. Or like what my son says, that's fiesta food, all right? And it says that there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, full of sores, who was laid at his gate. Well, yes, probably because he's not getting proper care, not getting proper baths. He was sick, and there were sores in his body. And he was desiring to be fed with crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Crumbs, breadcrumbs. Okay, how many of you have eaten with your hands? Guys, I've seen you eat with your hands. How come you don't want to? All right? And when you eat with your hands, what gets in your hands? Grease, right? Right? I mean, you know, when you've eaten with your hands, that's not the time, I better fix my hair. That's not the time you do that, right? Because you've got grease all over. Right? So what do you do to wipe off the grease? Do you go to your seatmates and say, excuse me, let me borrow your sleeves? No, you don't wipe your hands on the shirt of your friend, right? You get a piece of napkin and you wipe it there, right? Well, this rich guy gets bread and wipes off the grease with bread, throws it away, gets bread, wipes it, throws it away, gets bread, wipes it, throws it away. Not napkin, not cloth. He gets bread, wipes off the grease from his hands, and throws the bread away. That's what the poor man Lazarus was looking for. Can you give me that bread that he used as a napkin? I'd like to eat that. Okay? Well, he was so poor, didn't have anything. One was so rich, the other one was so poor. And it says here, he desired to be fed from the crumbs. That's all he could hope for. Apparently, he was being ignored. Apparently, he was not being given anything by the rich man because all he was hoping for were the breadcrumbs that he was throwing away, that he used to wipe his hands. Okay? And the only thing that would give him some comfort were the dogs who would lick his sores. All right, some people say, that's icky, that's yucky, that's, yeah, it is, but if you're that sick and nobody cares for you, you really don't care, and there's relief that's taken because of that. You understand what I'm saying? Okay? And it says here, okay, beginning with verse 22, see, the rich man was guilty of not sharing. Okay? Later on, we will find that when he asked Father Abraham says, they have Moses and the prophets. So this guy's a Jew. This guy was supposed to be a believer of the one true God. Behold, O Israel, thy God, the Lord is one. Because he's got Moses and the prophets. And according to the first five books of the Old Testament, there are verses there that says you are to take care of the poor, the alien, the orphan. If you're going to harvest a field, do not harvest everything. Leave something on the side so that the poor, the stranger, can go there and get their share. Do you understand what I'm saying? So this guy was, you know, someone who had a covenant with God, just like the other, the Jewish people. Okay? And because you're in covenant with God and he's rich, he was supposed to share his riches. But he did not. Okay? Blessings were meant to be shared, but he did not. So now we get to verse 22 to 26, where we find the great reversal taking place. And so it was that the beggar died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. Take note, when the beggar died, it didn't say whether he was buried or not. I don't know whether his body was dumped in a hole somewhere. I don't know. He was a poor man. People don't really pay attention to that. He died. He was sick. He was hungry. He was not well cared for. So naturally, he died. And then it says that the rich man died also. I don't know how many years he died, but he died. Maybe 10 years, 20 years, 30 years after the poor man died, he died also. And it says here, he was buried. There was a proper burial for him. If he was alive today, probably, they would be awake, or everyone would come and, you know, bring their gifts. And then there would be a mass, a high mass, with all the incense, with all everything. And maybe just because he's the one who died, there would be like 50 bishops that would come in, 100 priests that would be in procession, 250 deacons who would be there, okay? Maybe it was a grand mass. Maybe even the Pope would come. Do you understand what I'm saying? It would be all so solemn and all so holy, and everything would be like this. Finally, the mass would be ended, and then it would be open to people who would like to say everything. And people, maybe the governors, the mayors, definitely not the drug lords, okay? They would come up to the pulpit, and they would say nice things about this rich man. Oh, he could make these things to us. Oh, he made the nicest parties. Oh, he was a classy person. It's such a loss for the world that he died, because he was like this and he was like that. And then finally comes the procession. His coffin would be carried to the funeral car, and people would be crying. Maybe there would be people lining the streets. And a great procession, and he's being brought to the cemetery, and someone is singing, "Oh, my papa." Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay? And finally gets buried. Crying, 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 buried, 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 crying, crying, get gone. Nice burial. And people think, because he was such a rich, fine person, everything's okay with him. But your riches do not follow you when you die. You understand what I'm saying? It says here, this is what they didn't see. And being in torments, verse 23, and being in torments in Hades, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. So no more riches. He was in torment. Okay? This is going to be eternal pain, eternal suffering. It is suffering that is without end. And he's there. And it says here, he saw Abraham afar off, and he saw Lazarus. Somehow he recognized Lazarus. I don't know how, because I'm sure in Abraham's bosom, Lazarus no longer looked sick. I'm sure he no longer had the sores. I'm sure he doesn't look ragged or dirty. Okay? I mean, he's there. He looked at Lazarus and he saw Abraham. And look what he said in verse 24. And then he cried out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me. And he said, Lazarus," okay, "send Lazarus that he might dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame." First, you need to understand all your senses are active. Some people say, "I don't care what hell feels like, because if I die, I'm not going to feel anything." You will. You will. All your senses are going to be active. You're going to feel thirst. You're going to feel pain. Okay? Atena, he saw Father Abraham. He saw Lazarus. He could have said, "Is that you, Lazarus? Were you the one who was outside my gate? Lazarus, I'm sorry how I treated you. I thought I was being kind to you by letting you stay at my gate. I could have had my bodyguards remove you, but I let you stay there. I thought I was being charitable. I find now my mistake. Lazarus, would you forgive me? Would you please, could you come over and at least give me some water?" He could have spoken to Lazarus directly, but rich men don't talk to servants. No, no, no. They talk only to people of their own rank. So for him, even though he was in hell, it was below his dignity to talk to Lazarus. I need to talk to Abraham. Somehow, even in his suffering, he might still think he was still a big shot. You understand what I'm saying? And he dared not talk to Lazarus because Lazarus is beneath him. Okay? He's not on the same level, not on the same class. I'm higher, he's lower. And then he says to Abraham, "Could you talk to Lazarus? Send him over and dip some water and put in my cup." He still saw Lazarus as an errand boy. You understand what I'm saying? You would think this would bring some humility in you. But no, his character was set even though he was in hell. And so he was still acting high and mighty, somehow, despite the pain. Was asking Abraham, "Could you send that the guy's a beggar, and send him to me and tusan mo." You understand what I'm saying? Okay? But Abraham said, "Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things. And likewise Lazarus evil things. But now here he's comforted and you are tormented. And besides all this, there is a gulf between us. And there is a great gulf fixed. And those who want to pass from here to you cannot, nor can those from here pass to us." In other words, even though I want to do this, I can't, because there's a great gulf. He says, in your life, you had your reward, because that's all you lived for. Now understand this, he didn't go to hell because he was rich. And Lazarus didn't go to heaven because he was poor. Because if that's the only thing that's required, all we had to do was become poor. Jesus Christ did not even have to come down to die for us. God would have said, "Okay, guys, I don't have to send my son to you. You want to make it to heaven? Be poor." But there's something about poverty. You either become bitter at God, and some do. But some begin to call on God. The Bible says, the book of James says, the poor are rich in faith. You understand what I'm saying? They have a tendency to call out to God because now they see no man is looking after me. No man cares for me. And that my only hope is in God. A majority of people in trouble, like Lazarus, have a tendency to call out to God. You understand what I'm saying? Now there are some small percentage who would turn away from God and blame God for their troubles. Okay? But there are those who would call to God. And I believe that Lazarus was one of them. Otherwise, he would not be there. Do you understand what I'm saying? This rich guy was in hell, not because he was rich, but because he did not obey what the commandments said. Okay? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and to love God is to obey God. He knew. He knew what he should do, what he should have done, but he did not. He lived for himself instead of living for God by helping others out. Do you understand what I'm saying? There's so many things he could have done for Lazarus. He could have sent him to a doctor. He could have given him nice meals every day. He could afford it. Maybe not those crumbs that he would use as napkins. A decent meal. Maybe he would not eat banqueting food, but decent meal. Maybe he could clothe him. Okay? Something he could have done, but he did nothing. He ignored the commandments of God, and you ignore the Word of God, you ignore the God of the Word. Do you understand what I'm saying? So now he's no longer in heaven where he thought he should be. But it says here, he found himself there. Okay, now, he can't get any relief. He can't get any drink or anything, no help from the other side. Just impossible to cross from here to there. He sees happiness, joy, gladness, celebration, pleasure going on the other side. And here he only sees torment for himself and others around him. Now he starts thinking of somebody else. Now he starts thinking of someone else besides himself. And so now we go to the third principle. Consider seriously the word of God. In verse 27 to 31 it says, "Then he said, I beg you therefore, Father, that you would send him to my father's house." Okay, can't send him to me? Send Lazarus to my father's house. Again, he's still thinking, he's an errand boy. "For I have five brothers, that he may testify to them, lest they also come to this place of torment." Now he's thinking of his brothers. If you could only send Lazarus to them. Okay? I've got five brothers. They're like me. They're selfish and like me. Okay? If you could just have Lazarus testify to them, it might change their minds and they might not come here. Verse 29, "And Abraham said to him, they have Moses and the prophets." In other words, what Abraham says, they have the Holy Scriptures. They already have the Word of God. He said, "Let them hear them." And he said, "No, Father Abraham, but if one goes to them from the dead, they will repent." But he said to him, "If they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, even if one comforted them." In other words, if the word of God will not change their mind, a miracle from God will not do it either. What would be the reaction of the five brothers of the rich guy if they saw Lazarus back from the dead? They would say, "Isn't that the beggar who was outside the gate of our brother? Yeah. Why should we listen to him? He's just a con person. He's just trying to get money from us." But from the dead. Did he die? I never heard about his death. Were you there in his bed? Did you go to the church? Nobody heard about his death, right? You understand what I'm saying? Now think about the Lazarus of Jesus' day. The brother of Martha and Mary. Did he die? He did, right? And then what happened? Jesus Christ came and said to Martha, "Martha, take out the stone." And Martha says, "No. Lord, maybe if you came here like 24 hours after you." It's been 4 days. Jesus, body's not smelling good now. What did Jesus Christ say, "Martha, did I not tell you if you believe, you would see the glory of God?" And Martha moved the stone. And Jesus called, "Lazarus, come forth." What came forth? What came forth? Lazarus. Right? What happened? Did all of Israel believe? No. Right? The Pharisees could have said, "Did you hear about that? The guy actually died. It's been 4 days. And he called him his back. This fellow must be the Messiah." Or if we're not yet convinced, we should consider, a resurrection, someone who got resurrected did not convince them. You understand what I'm saying? Right? So we need, for our hearts to be tender before God, we should submit it to the Word of God. We are so exposed to the voice of the world through television, through radio, through through the internet. I mean, we can view whatever multimedia we want. We can watch movies we missed in the movie houses by going somewhere. Some of you got skills in being able to watch a free movie that some of us have to pay for. All right? We're familiar with the latest trends. We're familiar with the latest actions. We're familiar with what Duterte said. We're familiar with the Lima. Some of you have seen the film she's made. You understand what I'm saying? And you know what that does to your heart? Your heart was not really built to be exposed to those things. Jesus Christ told us what we should do with our heart. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. It's from the heart. What comes from the heart is what defiles man. It should not defile us. He's the one who said that we should take care of our hearts, right? The book of Proverbs says, guard your hearts. Out of your hearts flow the issues of life. What do you spend your hours on? Violent games? Drama movies? Chica? Or do you meditate on the Word of God? Do you listen to what God has to say? We need to pay attention to the Word of God. See, I believe this particular September, there is a shifting in the spirit. We are entering into a time of suddenness, breakouts, and breakthroughs. Okay? But when the moment comes, the ones who recognize this will be able to seize it and ride with it. Those who don't will not even know, will not even be aware that it was there. You need to be sensitive to what God is doing. We are entering a critical time. It is a period of suddenness, breakthroughs, and breakouts. Need to be able to ride with what God is doing. Amen? Now, how many of you learned something today? Praise God, let's all stand.